Hey, welcome to KTruth. My name is Eric Thompson. This is the Eric Thompson Show. We're kicking off a new online conservative television network to combat fake news. And the thing that really drives me is I feel like the Republicans are, they're the team that wants to play by the rules. We want to say yes, we tipped the ball before it went out of bounds. We want to help the people up, the people we're playing against. But then we don't want to fight when we're being attacked. And what's happening is the country has been declining for years. I can remember back, the first election I remember was Jimmy Carter. Inflation was high. Our hostages were being held by Iran. And the country was frustrated. There was a long lines at the gas stations. And Ronald Reagan comes on the scene, and the reason why he did so well is because people wanted change. And what Ronald Reagan did was he reestablished American pride. Now, I can remember back in 1976, we had the bicentennial, and cities all around the country had barbecues. I was in a small town in Iowa. We had a town of 200 people, and we had 200 people show up for the barbecue. And there was pride. Reagan gets in, the hostages are released, we beat the Russians in hockey, and the rest is history. One of the best political commercials you'll ever see, if you want to go back and watch it, was It's Another Day in America for Ronald Reagan's reelection. Our country just put in Donald Trump because of the following reasons. Number one, we're $20 trillion in debt. Trillion dollars. Okay? So, as I go through this list, we're starting with the debt. It shouldn't be that inconceivable for any of you why he was elected. Because nothing was going right on a national basis. $20 trillion in debt. And they're saying over 120 to 150 trillion in unfunded liabilities. That's Social Security and Medicaid. We're not dealing trillions of dollars. So that was a problem. Matter of fact, with Barack Obama, the debt, he doubled the debt. He had as much debt as every president up to him. That's why people voted for Donald Trump. 94 million Americans cannot find a job. 94 million can't find a job. That's why people wanted a change. Islamic terrorism, people getting their heads cut off on television, us knowing that people are sneaking across the border from these nations. That's a reason. Over 40 million people on food stamps. Now, when I was growing up, food stamps was a rarity, and I would see them at the store with like little vouchers. Okay? It's embarrassing. But what happened is the progressives, as they took over, wanted to make the government's influence in people's lives more palatable. So now we have EBT cards, where I go to Pizza Hut to get a pizza, and there's a guy next to me using his EBT card. Okay? 94 million out of debt. I'm sorry, 94 million can't find a job. We've got over 40 million people on food stamps, over 26 million people on welfare. We have probably 20 million plus illegal aliens and visa overstays in our country. All right. The problem with that is that there's a negative effect on our budget when that happens, actually an increase in debt, but it costs about $120 billion a year to have people here that are not paying taxes or as much taxes as they should be. And then they send the money back to, it could be Mexico, it could be Iran, it could be Somalia. But the problem is a large amount of people cannot get a job, high welfare, high food stamp usage. Obamacare? Seriously, if you're a Barack Hussein Obama supporter and your Republican friends are too nice to tell you the truth, Trump is constantly being called out for lying, exaggerating, whatever you want to call it. Now, by the way, let me preface this. I was a Ted Cruz supporter. But when it was Hillary Clinton, I became anybody but Hillary Clinton supporter. But what the Barack Obama's administration did is what he learned as a city organizer back in Chicago. It's almost like what, not comparing it, but it's similar to what Adolf Hitler said. If you repeat something, a lie, over and over and over again with conviction, people will consider it to be true. What did they say about Obamacare? You should vote for Obamacare because it will lower the average cost of medical to $2,500 per family. You should vote for this because it's going to lower the medical costs, $2,500 per family. Lower deductibles. You can keep your doctor if you want to keep your doctor. Problem is, that was a lie. And Grutter, who was the architect from MIT that helped write Obamacare, who even said it, some of the speeches he did, that they relied on the stupidity of the American citizen to get Obamacare pushed through. But that was a lie, a lie, a lie, a lie. And now what happens is today that the House Republicans finally released the Obamacare replacement bill. Now, why this is controversial, I don't know. Because you have millions of people that still did not get on, did not get medical coverage, even though Obamacare existed. People that liked Obamacare have $10,000, $12,000 deductibles. Rates gone up as much as I heard in Arizona, over 100%. So premiums are going up, deductibles are going up, doctors are dropping out. Aetna and some of the large insurance companies are pulling out of the exchanges. And the Republicans, instead of being able to say with conviction, hey, we got this great new medical plan. They're calling it the American Health Care Act. You can read it at readthebill.gop. Instead of being proud about it, they kind of were keeping it secret. Because we just don't want to be combative and we don't want to tell people or get ready, you know, fight with people about repealing Obamacare. Well, everything has been going wrong. So, and I don't know anybody that's happy with Obamacare. Maybe one or two people online that had a pre-existing condition, so they enjoy all of that extra coverage without having to pay the high premiums. But that's going to be that group of the uninsurable or the pre-existing conditions are still going to be taken care of in this bill. But that just this just was released today. The House Republicans released Obamacare replacement bill. It's going to be the American Health Care Act. It's going to repeal the taxes, the subsidies, and that stupid mandate that you have to have insurance, which I'm not going to say forgive, but I will always have an asterisk next to Judge Roberts of the Supreme Court for converting Obamacare from a fee to a tax, because it's Obamacare was not unconstitutional, but it's in, and that's why who we put in the courts is crucial. Now, what's really been bothering me the last couple months, because remember, Donald Trump's only been in office, 6 weeks? But running up to it, it seemed to be that the liberal media was getting a lot of little news feeds, or we got an anonymous report. And I was trying to figure out, like, where are all these stories coming from? Because they didn't show up during the election until right before the election took place. If you go back to the Bush story about Trump doing his little locker talk in a room with reporter Bush, then that blew up. Then they brought out the 15, 20 women that supposedly he fondled and molested and whatever he did. That fell apart. So the more and more stories kept getting released. But even though all that happened, I think because of the condition of our country, Trump got in, but the left will not let this go. And unlike the Republicans that even have everything on our side, of that we need to change the direction on about every issue. The Democrats and the progressives, which have been screwing up cities for generations, Baltimore, Washington, D.C., Chicago, on and on and on, L.A., New York, Democratic rule, high crime, high murder rate, high drugs, failing schools, failing cities. They seem to be able to walk with their head up, and the GOP is just trying to whimper around to stay out of trouble. But what's happening now is Donald Trump, President Donald Trump, a couple days ago, might even have been yesterday, it's going so fast, he goes on Twitter and goes, "Obama wiretapped me." So that's been the news, right? That's ridiculous. What is Trump up to? And he has no proof to go by. Well, the reason why I started KTruth was we're going to drill down a little deeper. I don't want to give you my platitudes and my opinions per se on some of these issues. I'm always going to have my conservative worldview, my disdain for progressive sociology. Socialism has never worked. It's failed in every country. It's been tried. Communism's killed millions and millions of people. People have always fought against it because it's against the God-given drive that we have for liberty and for freedom and for free will. So what I do is I go to people that I know study the Constitution, are historians, people that actually care about who we are and where we're going. I do not watch CNN. And for the conservatives that are watching this, I have no idea why you watch CNN or MSNBC or the Washington Times, the Washington Compost, the New York Times. I do not know why you read those papers or watch those TV shows at all. My plan is that we work on truth, we work on conviction, we work on policies, and we don't spend our energy fighting fake news. So what I did is I went and watched Mark Levin. Mark Levin, national syndicated talk show host, constitutional expert. He's on CRTV if you want to look up on his shows. He put out a point-by-point reason why it was not far-fetched that Obama administration would have wiretapped. And this is why. The Patriot Act came out after 9/11, right? And my liberal, I guess I can call him friends, Mr. Producer. But the Patriot Act was the uproar of the left. Oh, invasion of privacy. Man, they're snooping in my emails and my phone. But before that, the Congress had set up the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court. It's a FISA court. Now, what this court is actually like a parallel to the Supreme Court. It decides if the government can wiretap you. So while CNN and the fake news are saying that Trump has no basis to his concerns about being wiretapped at Trump Tower, the reality is the FISA courts received two petitions from the Obama administration to wiretap Trump. Now, it's supposed to be to catch foreign spies. That's the gist of it. But what they're saying is that the petitions that were put in, submitted to the FISA court, was to try to catch some of Trump's staffers or people in the election to see if they were talking to the Russians. The good old dreaded Russians. That's all I hear about anymore. Russians. The Russians did it. The Russians did this. So here's a little trivia question. What president said to the Russians, "After I get reelected, I'll be more free to do what I would like to do for my agenda"? That's a paraphrase, but who was it? Was it Trump? President Trump? Was it Clinton? Bush? No, it was Barack Hussein Obama. "Wait till the election's over, and then when I get reelected, then I will be free to do what I want to do." So we need to focus on truth. We need to focus on the acts, who's doing them, the proof. There's no reason Barack Obama got into office. Half a term as a U.S. senator, state senator out of Chicago, unknown, didn't release his college transcripts. We don't know anything. We didn't know anything about him, but he was president of the United States. And part of Saul Alinsky's training in a book called Rules for Radicals is to keep the people off kilter and to attack and paralyze the people that you want to stop, change policy for, you know, to reorganize the city. So here's Donald Trump, President Trump. He's in office. He finds out about the FISA request because he's president of the United States now. Now, think about it. He has access to pretty much everything as the chief executive officer. He finds out. I personally wouldn't have maybe come out as he did and tweet. but I think what we're going to find out through Mark Levin, Rush Limbaugh, and I know you probably, if you're liberal, you don't like Rush Limbaugh, but that's okay. He's a guy that spent over 30 years on politics daily, talking about researching the relationships with people in the government. But they're saying that there's no reason why it would be ridiculous to say that it's impossible that Obama wouldn't do this. Because here's the reality. Obama's been spying on people around the world. If it's Merkel, if it's the Italians, we have drones that are killing Americans overseas that are terrorists. So I'm not saying I have a problem with that, but this isn't that unusual for the government to spy on people and to wiretap and to listen to them. So if you disengage your emotion here and say, okay, because President Trump said it, it must be terrible, it must be wrong, and I'm just not going to listen to it. Why don't you stop for a second and say, would it be reasonable that if you're a Democrat and you do not want Donald Trump to win the presidency and you think he's talking to the Russians, wouldn't it be reasonable to think that the Obama administration, who wanted to continue his legacy, expecting Hillary Clinton to become president, would want to get more negative information on Donald Trump? That's not a conspiracy. That's just logical. If you're in that political realm where you're not living, you're not functioning in a truth, in a rational, logical way of just trying to win the election. No, if you're relying on negativity, negative stories, dirt, then that would be a logical conclusion to me that he did it. Robert Barnes, a reporter, there's articles all over Breitbart.com. But it was ludicrous to claim Obama never spied on Americans when he drone bombed American citizens around the world. Actually, his attorney Robert Barnes on Breitbart. But he goes through here. This person, you know, the allegations that Trump raises are allegations that are derived directly from what the newspapers have reported. Who reported it? The Guardian newspaper, the BBC, Heat Street, and the New York Times, the Washington Post. Where they all talked about being there, that there is an interagency panel of people who were involved in an investigation who purportedly requested and obtained various means of intercepting phone calls. So the liberal papers, conservative papers, no. It's when my wife was over in France several years ago, she was eating dinner by herself, and the reason why is the girl she went on the trip with, her friend, was resting. And she had four older Frenchmen. See, they saw her sitting by herself, and they invited her over. And they told her, they said, you know, what's amazing about Americans? And she said, what? Is that you think your government is moral. Our government is just like any other government. You have some people that are trying to do good for us, and you have a lot of people that are trying to get wealthy. Considering that our political system now has become a profession. Yeah, I mean, it used to be, and it is in Texas, where you're a part-time politician, full-time farmer, full-time doctor, attorney. They come to Austin once a year, do the work of the business of Texas, and they go home. But here, you can go into the House of Representatives with no money, and you can leave a millionaire in 2 years. But why leave after 2 years? Why not get reelected? So what do? Since you only have 2 years, is you're a Tea Party, ready to fight for overturning Obamacare, lowering taxes, traditional marriage. You're all for that. And then when you get in the office, you just quietly vote for the bills. You don't actually write any bills or get any bills up to get sponsored. So you can get reelected and reelected and reelected, which is why I'm from term limits, constitutional amendment for term limits. So where we're at today is that you have the President of the United States, who's claiming that he was wiretapped. Barack Hussein Obama, the former president, says that he wasn't responsible for it if it happened, which is a weak, weak answer. Your president, you know if that was requested through the FISA courts. So the House is putting out the bill to repeal Obamacare. They possibly are going to start hearings. Who knows? Maybe they'll even try to call in Barack Obama to testify on the wiretap possibility. But everything is in paralysis right now, because what you have is you have the fake news, which is the ones I mentioned earlier, that are taking stories, twisting stories. They even have a camera. Looks like facing into the Oval Office. So there's a fake news story, which is either, I think they're lip reading experts. They can read lips really good. Because here's what happens. There's a camera, and the fake news said, CNN, like uproar in the White House, a combative argument between the president and his advisors. Well, all you can see is a video, no vote, and there's no audio. You just see Bannon going like this. And that was him screaming at the president. It was unbelievable what was happening in there. Off of him doing this, and with the camera shooting all the way across the gate, all the way over to the Oval Office, outside. And that supposedly was showing that the Trump administration is collapsing. And people are believing that. I'm seeing people on Twitter, which, by the way, if you want to get a hold of me on Twitter, there's two places. There's ET Talk Show. There's about 500,000 people on there that would love to see your tweets if they also follow you. Or KTruth TV. But they're on Twitter right now, and there's this war going on. Ah, yeah. Trump's falling apart. He's got fighting with Bannon, and everybody's upset in there. And he's mad at Attorney General Sessions for recusing himself from the Russian investigations, which we'll cover after the break. But that little soundbite of that fake video, of that video with a fake interpretation of what's going on in there, is now going to carry the news. So the liberal media will get it. Well, today, CNN shared that the Trump administration was having internal issues. And that to go along with that, the President Trump has his unverified, bogus, that's my word, but ridiculous allegations of wiretapping. And that's the news today. Not that all Americans are going to get relief on Obamacare. That should be actually across both parties. I'm not sure how this ended up being just, oh my goodness, that terrible, destructive, overpriced, non-effective waste of a medical plan with trillion-dollar deficits is going to get fixed, which all of us should be wanting that. No, because once you say, House Republicans, then it's bad. Because there's no way that the Republicans would want to do anything to help everybody. That's impossible. So that's what's going on that just came out. And you're not getting much, you're not going to hear much about it until probably tomorrow, because the liberal media now has to go through it. Again, it was readthebill.gop. They got to go through it now and talk about how the Republicans are going to want to take away medical care from people, that they're going to offer less services, that they're going to shut down clinics, because that's what they have to do. That's Saul Alinsky's plan, is you just keep going after things, you paralyze it, you ridicule it, you ridicule the story. So we'll go from President Trump shouldn't be taken serious on the wiretaps to how the Republicans are wanting to take away medical care from low income and needy people that need medical care. Now, what we should be talking about is the amount of terrorism that's going on around the world and our open borders, and having an honest discussion about that. President Trump put out his modified executive order. It was filed new, so it's not the one that was held up by the courts incorrectly. But the president did another executive order today, which is going to keep out unvetted immigrants from, now it's six nations, it's no longer seven nations, but it's going to keep people out from Iran, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, Syria, and Yemen. I guess this might get more blown up than the Obamacare repeal. It's going to be one of the two. But President Trump did that today. And after the break, we're going to go over some more details about it. We'll go over that, and I'm going to go over just some more of my views on things that we need to be talking about, maybe some solutions that we can start working on. But again, if you want to get a hold of me on Twitter, it's ET Talk Show or KTruth TV. I think Facebook, it's KTruth TV and Eric Thompson Show. I don't go on Facebook too much because I can't stand Zuckerberg at all. I mean, if I had a non-Christmas list, I think Zuckerberg would probably be my number one guy there. So we get back, we're going to go over the new executive order, and we're going to go over a few other things. So thank you again for joining me. My name is Eric Thompson, and I'll be right back.
Brittany's Park Avenue Pet Grooming. Top quality grooming for dogs of all sizes. 12 years of combined experience with dog shows and pet grooming. Specializing in breed trims and hand scissoring. Brittany's Park Avenue Pet Grooming is open Tuesdays through Saturdays and is located at 5730 North 1st Street, Suite number 115. Visit parkavenuefresno.com or call 559-709-7279.
Christy Majors is your local real estate connection. With a solid, hardworking team, traditional listings, short sales, probate listings, and foreclosures are treated in a personal and caring way and close in a timely fashion. Since 2009, Team Majors has closed more than $75 million worth of homes all over California. Reliable and trustworthy, Christy and her team will go the extra mile for every client, whether selling or buying a home. So give Team Majors a call at 559-464-5606 or visit teammajors.com.
Need a dentist? Call Dr. David Wright at 559-222-6213 or visit bitemedental.com.
The Fifth Quarter, a restaurant and sports bar in Visalia. 24 of your favorite beers on tap and a full bar. Entertainment for all. Pool tables, karaoke, a DJ, and even a drag show. Watch the game with us and get some great food. Burgers, sushi, and much more. Don't wait for overtime. Head into the Fifth Quarter for a great time today.
Thank you. Since 1998, Cabinetry Design Center has been in the cabinet business and is sustained by 3 decades of unparalleled experience in the industry. We're your one-stop shop for exceptional cabinet designs. Custom cabinets complement the way your home looks and functions. We can make your dream cabinets an aesthetic and functional reality. Cabinetry Design Center will guide you in every step of the process. We make sure that you get what you want and love the finished product. Your cabinets are in good hands with us. Call Cabinetry Design Center, a family-owned business, at 559-277-3500.
Realtor Letty Pingitori is a broker associate with Keller Williams, and she is also a voiceover artist. Contact Letty at 559-281-4568.
Elite Custom Painting is here for you. We can help you achieve that custom look with premium paints and custom texture with quality workmanship at reasonable prices. Discounts for veterans and senior citizens. Prompt, reliable, professional, Elite Custom Painting delivers superior customer service. Specializing in residential interior and exterior painting, cabinet repainting, wallpaper removal, and retexturing. Call today for your free estimate at 559-970-8154.
Hey, thank you for staying with me. This is Eric Thompson again on KTruth and KTruth.com you can go to. We also have KTruth.tv, which is just a TV feed with some links to my Spreaker account. I do podcasts, so if you want to hear podcasts on these same issues, those are going to be done daily. So just try to get out an hour of some information. But as we go and do the show more often and get going, I get more comfortable with this, we'll have live call-ins, so you'll be able to call into the show. I think we're going to be fancy-smancy and have a, what's that called up there? The voiceover IP call-in. What's that little thing called? You said where you can call in? Skype, okay. I'm old. Skype's like a newer thing. So we'll have Skype, so if you can actually call in, I think we'll be able to see your pretty face next to my ugly face. And with my large weight, I'll make you look skinny, so that would be another reason to call in. What we were talking about before we went to the break was the country's, you know, our country was struggling. President Trump got in. There was all these leaks coming in. All of a sudden, we've got people from the State Department and other departments that were leaking out stories. Now, I don't know about you, but if I became president, I am getting rid of everybody that worked for the previous administration, if it's Democratic. Or if you're liberal, you'd want to get rid of the conservatives. Because I've never seen so many leaks in my life. It's like a house with a bad roof in a rainstorm. I mean, leak after leak after leak after leak. And I think as we go along here, that's going to be required. Because if you look what happened with General Kelly, you're talking a guy 30-plus years serving the country honorably, and then all of a sudden he gets in to run the national security, and then he's gone. Because they're calling it this dark government or this sub-government that the liberals have set up to try to dismantle and take down the Trump administration. But before I go over to the new executive order, which we'll do the rest of the show on, there was an article here on Gateway Pundit. It's, here's the list. More than a dozen proven victims of Obama's mini wiretaps. Now, this generated 1,591 comments on the website. It's a lot of comments. The reason why is that everyone's like, oh, President Obama would never wiretap. He's nice B.O., you know. He's a family man. Well, here is some stories, okay, from the article. This is from WikiLeaks. List was February 23rd on the administration wiretaps. The U.S. National Security Agency bugged a private climate change strategy meeting between the U.N. and Angela Merkel. A FISA court? I mean, what? What does that? I don't care. Even though I don't believe in global warming, I'm sorry. That's ridiculous. Obama bugged chief of staff, the chief of staff of UN High Commissioner for Refugees, for long-term interception targeting his Swiss phone. So they're going after a guy in the United Nations that's helping with refugees. Obama singled out the director of Rules Division of the World Trade Organization, Johan Human, and targeted his Swiss phone for long-term interception. Obama stole sensitive Italian diplomatic cables, detailing how Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu implored Italy's Prime Minister to help patch up his relationship with the president. Now, you're going to get a wiretap to see how Italy's Prime Minister and Netanyahu were going to try to patch up that relationship with Barack Obama? Obama intercepts top European Union and Japanese trade ministers' phone calls. Obama explicitly targeted five other top EU economic officials for long-term interception, including their French and Austrian allies. Okay, so don't tell me it's unbelievable that the Obama administration would wiretap Donald Trump before he was president and try to see if they could get dirt on him in the name of national security, intercepting spy communications between people in the Trump administration and those dreaded Russians. Come on. They've done it before. It's the old analogy, the pig analogy, right? Or it's like me. When I try to diet, I try not to go to Starbucks, but I always give in. So the pigs will go back. You clean them, they go back to mud. You give a unethical government power, Patriot Act, FISA courts. They will abuse it, and they will continue to abuse it. Now, on a non-abusive situation, Donald Trump, President Trump, put out another executive order today. It's a revised executive order suspending the refugee program as well as entry to the United States from travelers from those six mostly Muslim countries. I don't know why they have to say that, but they say it anyway. Yes, there's Muslims in these countries, but there's 85 to 90% of Muslims are not in Iran, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, Syria, and Yemen. It's not a Muslim ban. This is a list of countries that Barack Hussein Obama's administration had put out as being dangerous because of the amount of terrorism in those countries and the lack of vetting that these countries were offering of their own citizens that we could verify before they came into our country. Yemen and these other countries, you can remember back in the Clinton days, the USS Cole, they blew a hole in it. You obviously don't have to go more. Syria, the gassing of the people, Sudan, Somalia, on and on and on. Libya, that one kind of trips me out because I was over in Israel, Jordan, Turkey, Greece, France, several countries a couple years ago. And I would run into people. And they know I was American, and I'd say, well, what do you think of Assad in Syria? I like Assad. Well, what do you think of Mubarak in Egypt? We liked Mubarak. What do you think of what happened in Libya with Gaddafi? Gaddafi wasn't doing any harm to anybody. So what we did through the Hillary Clinton State Department, Barack Hussein Obama presidency, is we went in and basically removed Gaddafi from Libya, which then caused Benghazi, another show. We removed Mubarak, helped the Muslim Brotherhood to remove Mubarak, and now Christians are getting martyred in Egypt. And we got rid of Saddam Hussein in Iraq. Now, I was in Desert Storm the first time. We chased him back out of Kuwait, back up into Iraq. We didn't get him for what he was doing at that point. The second time we went in, a whole nother conversation there. So, but to say all that, the countries that are now unstable, the Libyas and the Syrias and the Yemen. Oh, must be President Trump. No. Sorry. These countries now are basically tribal ran. They have unstructured governments. It's been like that for Somalia, Sudan, Yemen for years. Syria, we know, is split up between, you know, you have ISIS, and now Russia's in there mixed in that. You have this huge refugee crisis because instead of helping set up safety zones in Syria, we're shipping them all over the world, even though there's no jobs, there's no cultural environment for them to assimilate into. But that's a whole other issue. But basically, this ban is put in. It's stopping the refugee program from Syria and all these countries. It's putting a ban on for 120 days. Okay, so say this with me. This is not permanent. This is 120 days for the express purpose of working with those governments, making sure there's proper vetting processes and double checking and making sure that if they're coming into our country, that we want them and that they want to be here to work and to help our country be better, a better place to live, versus coming in wanting Sharia law and wanting to get on our welfare system. So that's what this is about. Again, Secretary of State Tillerson, Attorney General Jeff Sessions, Homeland Security John Kelly, they announced this. This has been worked through, should not have any problems with the courts again. But they're putting a cap, once this is lifted, on 50,000 people instead of 110,000. Now, when it comes to this immigration thing, and I'm not going to go over this, the border, that's going to be next show. One thing I hope they look at too is this getting rid of the H-1B work visas. So this is to stop from people from those countries that the Barack Obama administration had identified and the President Trump's team had agreed with need to be vetted. But we also need to stop the 60,000 foreign workers coming in from some of these countries, as well as China and the Ukraine and Korea and India, that are taking our tech jobs from our kids that are graduating from college and can't find a job, part of that 94 million. So we'll talk about the H-1B. If you are on the news and you hear H-1B work visas, in my world, those are bad, really bad. Okay, here's what's in the executive order. Now, if you're watching this and you are really hating me right now, which is possible, it's okay, I'm used to it. Tell me let me know in your own mind. Now, you can also, you know, go on and tweet me if you have a real problem with it. And in a couple of weeks, you'll be able to call in and you can really tell me. But here's a couple of things that's included in that executive order. And I don't know how anybody in the world can have a problem with these. These are just a few of them. But this is out of Breitbart again. Trump's executive order requires that the government reports on honor killings that are committed by migrants. The Trump administration, Homeland Security, FBI, CIA, they want to know everyone that kills their family member or kills somebody in America to be honorable, as an honorable killing to prevent that person from insulting Muhammad. Is this wrong? Like, is any of you out there think that this is possibly like the wrong thing to do? To keep track of people that killed people for the sake of keeping their daughter, son, wife, uncle, coworker, they kill them to say they did it, to as an honorable thing to keep them from insulting Muhammad. The reason why I know this is my wife, when we were in Texas, she worked at I'm not going to say the name of it, but a big theme park. And a girl in her department, she would see her. She did nails, this girl. And she would see her every once in a while, and she was from a Muslim family. Well, something happened, but the mom and the two daughters moved out of the house, and they moved into an apartment in Grapevine, Texas. Christmas Eve, their dad, Muslim, shows up in a Santa outfit. They open the door, and he kills them all. Because it was an honor killing. He was going to keep his daughters who had left Islam, who were dating Christian boys, to keep them from stumbling and dishonoring Allah. He had a moral obligation. The honorable thing to do was to kill his daughters. And he did. So that girl did not come back to work. She was buried because of the honor killings. Well, Trump administration wants to know where that guy went to mosque, you know, where he went to his religious studies, what drove him to do that, and keep a list of what was compelling people to do these acts so we could be aware and, yes, eventually monitor or be more diligent that if other people have those tendencies, Sharia law believing, which about half of some neighborhoods or more want Sharia law instead of our U.S. Constitution. Look up Sharia law on Google. I'm not a Sharia law expert. I've read it through to know their basic tenets from their own writings. But Sharia law is a 6th century government system that's cloaked by a religion called Islam. And this is what we need to be aware of when it comes to these killings and what drives them to do it. Okay? Another part of the executive order is that officials must identify immigration applicants who support acts of violence. That's on the application on most countries. Do you intend on, doing any harm while in the country? Do you have any belief systems that will compel you to cause harm to the citizens of the country? The thing I run into a lot, which blows me away, but when you do a lot of debating, you're going to run into people of different views. I would say, this is not a fact, this is my opinion, over 95% of the terrorist acts done in the world, there was the killing and murdering and maiming of people, is one religion, one group, and that's Islam. Did not say all Muslims are terrorists. I said the Sharia believing sects. So what the Trump administration wants to know is for people coming in, fill out the application. Do you support this belief system? Do you support this belief system? Would you do this if we allow you in the country? That is not an unrealistic expectation because we have 340 million people in our country. The primary role of the government is to raise up a common defense for us to keep us safe from foreign nations and domestic terrorists now. So for them to know who's coming in and what their motivation is, do they want to assimilate? Do they not want to assimilate? Do they have any ideology that would give them justification for hurting people? Then that's part of the act here. So what you're going to see happen is this is going to get spun on the media to where this is a xenophobic, Islamophobic law, or not law, let me rephrase that, an executive order. Because remember, over 85% of the Muslims in the world are not from those six nations that we're going to do vetting in. They're asking them in the vetting process, do you want to do harm to the United States? Is there anything that are you anti-American? That's logical. That would be in any country in the world. When I went into Germany and I went into Austria, when I went into Israel, I actually got stopped coming back out of Israel. Not the burqa, the girls with the burqas are going through, everybody's going through, but they stopped the fat guy from America. And the reason they even asked me coming in from Jordan back into Israel, what is your grandfather's name? Where was your father born? 44? Okay, 58? Okay, cool. Sorry about that. I'm learning the magic clock system here. But when I was coming back, you had to go through the line. So if you wanted to get into Germany, you had to go through Germany, through their immigration. If you wanted to go into Austria, no country let me get off an airplane and just walk into their country. They had to punch my passport. They had to know who I am. And they asked me, what are you doing in the country and how long are you going to be here? Okay? When it comes to our country, if we ask somebody who's coming from a foreign country, why do you want to come to America? What are you going to do and how long are you going to stay? We are xenophobic and Islamophobic. It's ignorant. And I don't even know why they get that kind of play on the media. But these are some of the main things in the executive order. 120 days. We want to vet the people that are coming in. And we want to stop the immigration from Syria and some of these countries until we know who's coming in and put in place a plan that will help us be successful going forward. But to finish up, I think the main thing driving this whole divide between liberals and conservatives and this ongoing battle, I did a show last week, a podcast on who Saul Alinsky is and George Soros. If you want to look those guys up. George Soros is a billionaire, very wealthy, successful investor that is funding the Black Lives Matter movement, the uprisings in Baltimore and D.C. and Chicago, the people that are getting paid up in Berkeley to tear down the lights and bust stuff up. Well, his call is for... its call is for violence, to intimidate, to take over by coercion. Well, this was an interesting article. If you remember, the Attorney General Loretta Lynch was, I think, one of the worst attorney generals ever. But picture this. This is a lady that was like supposed to be like the top police officer in the nation. This came out March 6th. 2017. It says AG Loretta Lynch issues plea for more protesting, blood, and death in the streets. Yeah, that's how you're going to get things accomplished. Is more protesting, death, and blood in the streets. It says here, are the elements of the former Obama administration orchestrating another civil war? Former Attorney General issued a video on behalf of the Senate Democrats. On behalf of the Senate Democrats, okay? Urging Americans to resist in the time of fear and uncertainty for so many people. Lynch lamented our rights being assailed, being trampled on, and even rolling back in this video. She said it required work to achieve the ideals of our founding fathers. Bogus, okay? And it goes on and on in here. It's been people, individuals who have banded together, ordinary people who simply saw the need to be done and came together and supported these ideals. They marched, they bled, and yes, some of them even died. So thank you again for joining me. Looks like we're finishing up. That was a fast hour. Man, I'm sure if you're watching me, you're thinking that was a long hour, but I don't blame you. So again, my name is Eric Thompson. You get a hold of me on ktruth.com or ktruth.tv, and we will see you next week. Take care.